happens. There was one kibbutznik in Israel, his name is Eliyahu, not religious. He sell animals. He sell animals. And obviously when there's the first animal born, it's holy, so he can, nobody will buy it. Religious people won't buy from a non-religious animal any animals because they don't trust him. Maybe it's the firstborn. So we don't want to take a risk. He's not going to tell us the truth. Don't know. By looking at the animal, you don't know if it's a firstborn or not. So what happened? So they told him, you want to expand your business, your marketing, get a certificate from the Rabbanut, and you're going to be able to sell to religious people. You're going to double your business. So you pay a fee for supervision of the rabbi on your animal. He's going to stamp the animals, which one is born, firstborn and not. And then you're going to be able to do a lot more business. So guess what happened? This guy said, you know what? It's good for business. Why not? Okay, rabbi, I'm gonna do it. So what happened? In the meantime, the rabbi was supposed to come and inspect his place and give him a certificate that now he's supervised by the rabbis. In the meantime, one animal was born already. Now, one of the things the rabbi is doing with him, he takes his animals and they make a shtar, an agreement like they all sold to a goy. Same thing we do with the chametz in Pesach. You sell it to a goy, and like this, the chametz is not in your position. So once you sell the animal to a goy, even though the animals are in Israel, they cannot be holy anymore. Because only the animals that are owned by a Jew, their animals that are born, firstborn, have holiness in them. But if it's owned by an Arab or any other goy, they are not holy. And there's no problem to use them. So by the Jew selling it to the goy for X amount of years, even though he continued to use it, but there's some kind of agreement that really, if the goy is not reliable, he can come and take it. It's his, he cannot do anything. But there's some kind of agreement that you and the goy understand that I bought it, but it's really yours. And you continue to benefit from it, even though I own it. Ahmad own it, and Yosef enjoy from it. And he gets some kind of a benefits from doing the deal, the goy. So the rabbi told him, oh, it's too late already. This one we cannot sell to a goy because it was born before we made the agreement with a goy. That animal has to be killed. You have to kill it. He said, what? No, mapitom, I'm not going to do it. What happened? In the end, the animal died anyway. And he threw it from the cliff. He had a big cliff in a kibbutz. All the animals who died from sicknesses and problem or in birth, he come to the cliff. And he throw them all the way down. They go about 100 yards down on the cliff. And the coyotes and the hyenas, they come and eat everything until the last gram of meat. Only bones left. Within days, you come, once in a while used to go down, only bones. No, nothing left, not even the skin. They finish everything. After a few days, he went down and he saw many, many bones of animals that he threw in the last week. Because he had to remember thousands of animals. So every once in a while, every day, he throw. Which animal nobody touched? The bone, the firstborn. Even the coyotes and the hyenas didn't touch it. It was complete. Complete body. All the other animals, this one had a stamp. The rabbi took it, you know, they heat it up and they make a stamp in the animal, like a tattoo. The one with the tattoo, nobody touched. Everything else, they finished to the end. So the rabbi told him, what are you, you fool? You don't see in your own eyes? Even the animals saw that it's holy. The animals, they don't have a free choice, like a robot. Hashem showed them, don't touch this animal, it's mine. The other ones is yours. And that's how he started to get closer to Judaism, and the rest is history. He became a real Baruch Hashem tzaddik. Also, there was one guy, his name was Yaakov. He's working for the Israeli police. What's his job? He has a big van and a robot. And the robot, every time they have a suspicious object, like a bag or something, could be a bomb, they call the police, and the police send this van with a robot. And he has like a remote control, and he sends the robot, and the robot shoots at the bag, shoot, and burn the bag. And in case it's a bomb, they make everyone go very far. And if it's a bomb, it explodes, and the life of people gets saved. You know? So this Yaakov saw that every time he blow up a bag, most of the time it wasn't any bomb. It's a suspicious thing somebody put next to a garbage can or in the middle of a mall. So they blow it up. The bomb, the robot explode only the, it aim only at that bag or the box, whatever it is. It doesn't make a big damage to the area. So what happened is, after that, they come and they open the bag, and they always find books, all kinds of things. So he said, this guy wasn't religious for many years. He said, every time there was tefillin inside, or the Torah, books of Torah, Sidur, Torah, it never got damaged. The clothes went on fire. Food went on fire. The tefillin and the books stay complete. And again, and again, and again, and he said to himself, why, it cannot be coincidence. We see a miracle here. One time, it explodes the bag, and he opened the bag, and he see a book. He write the Holy Bible, it says, and it was burned. Half of it burns black. He said, oh, here goes my theory. Up to now, I never saw that the books ever got damaged. He started to look into that book. What was the other half that was burned? The New Testament. Comes together, the old and the new one. So he said, wow, finally I understand. And this Yaakov became Baal Tshuva, Baruch Hashem. This is too interesting story, how a person was able to see a miracle and wake up. Most people see miracles, they never wake up. Go back to their nonsense.
Seven years of lectures. Seven months of film editing. Countless hours of study by two rabbis. Information we received over 3,000 years ago. All for this moment. To whom had greed? The movie.
There's a small number in your life. It shouldn't take over your whole life. If you satiate it, you're never gonna have enough.
The Sofer clamp, when it gets a hold of something, it does not let go.
Time for us to rectify what we have done.
The normal number should be somewhere around 20 million or higher.
You're never going to have control of it. If you start it, you only feed it when it's permissible, according to the Torah.
Pornography is as addictive as crack cocaine.
You're always going to be happy. Including this world and the next. Baruch Adonai Le'olam. Amen.